Well, Happy New Year to everybody. We are going to be looking today at the book of Mark. And for the text, Mark chapter 8, beginning with verse 34. Then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit his own soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes to his Father's glory with the holy angels." The book of Mark was written by John Mark, and he had the two names. John was from his Jewish background, and Mark from the Greek background. And as a young man, he actually left Antioch with Paul, and he went on the first missionary journey, but he didn't stick it out. Partway through, he decided to leave. And so later, when Paul took his second missionary journey, he refused to allow John Mark to go with him. Now, later on, they seemingly reconciled, but there was a problem, at least for a while. Now, it is said that Mark was very close to Peter. And probably the book of Mark, it was the first of the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, that was written. It was also the shortest, but he got his information primarily from Peter. And in this book, I want to notice three things. By the way, I use the little chat program that's available on the internet now. Some of you may have heard of that. And it actually provided part of my outline. Now, I didn't use anything but the major points for a couple, and I changed them, but I just wanted you to know that I got a little bit of help. So the three points are, first of all, faith, then service, and finally, priority. So let's look at those together. First of all, trust the Lord. Mark 9:23, everything is possible for one who believes. Jesus says that. You know, in English, we have three words that mean almost the same. In Greek, there's only one. The Greek word is pistuo, and I'm not asking you to remember that for a test, but in English, it can be translated trust, sometimes faith, sometimes belief. And they mean basically the same, with just a little bit of difference in shading. And so Jesus, when he was alive, taught about faith. And he said, everything is possible for the one that has faith, the one that believes. And he lived that in his own life. He had faith when he walked on the water. He had faith when he healed those that were sick. He had faith when he fed 5,000 plus people with just a little bag of fish and biscuits. He had faith when he called Lazarus to come out of the tomb after he had been dead for 4 days. Jesus had faith, and he talked to his disciples about having faith as well. He said, if you have the faith of a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it shall be done. Now, the disciples heard that, but they didn't always practice it. He told them on several occasions, why do you doubt? Only believe. And on one occasion, there was a young boy, and by the description in the Bible, he seemed to have epilepsy, and they described it as being a bad spirit. And Jesus was away, and when Jesus came back, the father ran to Jesus and said, your disciples couldn't help at all. They tried to heal him, but they could not. And Jesus said, oh, you unbelieving generation, how long can I stay with you? And so the boy was brought to him, and Jesus healed him. And the disciples later on asked, well, Lord, why could we not do anything? Because he had given them that authority, and he said, this kind only comes out by way of prayer. Some versions say also fasting. The main thing was their unbelief, and they were not able to do anything. And so we know that in our relation with God, it is impossible to please God without faith. The only way that you can please Him is by faith, by believing in Him. And so there were some, even in the New Testament times, that had great faith that were not disciples. There was the centurion, and he wanted Jesus to heal his servant, and Jesus was going to go with him, and the man said, well, no need to do that. I command all these men, and I give them instructions, and they do it. And Jesus was astounded by his great faith, and immediately he was healed. The servant was healed. And so Jesus talked about this kind of faith that we have to have. And he said, you don't have to have a whole lot, just a mustard seed amount of faith. Now, there was also in the New Testament the woman that had, and is found in Mark chapter 5, there was the woman that had an issue of blood. She'd had this medical problem for some 12 years. She had been to physician after physician, and nobody was able to help her. And so she had faith, and she said, you know, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I can be healed. And so she went up behind him, and she touched it, and Jesus immediately felt power going from him, and he said, who touched me? And the disciples said, well, Lord, what are you talking about? Everybody's crowding up against you and touching you. But the woman knew that he was aware of what he had done, and so he said to her, woman, your faith has made you whole. Your faith has healed you. And so faith is able to do that. I was reading about some missionaries. I'd heard about them before. James and Mary Moffat. And they went to what is today Botswana. And for 6 years, they worked to try to lead people to Christ, and they had no converts at all. Well, the mission board wrote to them and said, you know, maybe it's time for you to move on to a different place. But they refused because they believed that God had sent them there. And so they stayed, and what, 2 more years went by, still no converts. And then a woman wrote to them and said, can I be of some help to you? How can I help? And they said, in faith, send us a communion set because we're going to need it. And sure enough, very soon, 6 people became Christians and started meeting together. The day before they were supposed to have their communion service, the communion set arrived. If something looks difficult, if something looks impossible, know that Jesus said that for everyone that has faith, nothing is impossible with God. So the first lesson here is to trust in the Lord. Secondly, it is to serve the Lord. And Jesus said, whoever wants to be great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you shall be the slave of all. Jesus was telling us that the standard for greatness with God is very different than the standards of men. And he said that he himself came not into the world to be served, but instead to serve others. He came not as a conquering Lord, but he came as a suffering servant, and he died on the cross. And he gave an example of this kind of service to his disciples shortly before he was taken to be crucified. They came in, and they all had dusty feet. And normally, it was a slave that would wash the feet. And Jesus, the very Son of God, took a basin of water and a towel, and he knelt down, and he began to wash the dusty, nasty feet of his disciples. If Jesus could do that, so can we. And, you know, this kind of service is not something that is instinctive for us. It is something that we learn. And so Jesus on one occasion was with his disciples, and James and John said, "Lord, may we ask you a question?" He said, "Of course, go ahead." And they said, "When you come to your kingdom, can one of us sit on the right side of you and one on the left?" And Jesus said, "That's not mine to give." And the other disciples heard about it. They became upset because that's the position that they wanted. And once again, Jesus told them, to be great in the kingdom is to be the greatest service. I was reading about a pastor. He was in the United States pastoring a good-sized church during the 19th century. And in 1873, he gave up that church, and he wanted to go with William Booth in England. And Booth started the Salvation Army. They had a great program of evangelizing first, but also helping people with their personal needs. They would feed the hungry. They would clothe those that needed clothing. And so Brindle went there, and he had the idea that maybe he could become a bishop. But when he got there, Booth was not impressed. And he said, "Sometime you've been leading, but it's time that you learned how to serve." And so he said, "I want you to clean the boots of the other trainees." And so there he was one day cleaning boots, and he said, "You know, I left everything to be able to come here, and here I am cleaning these boots. Maybe I should quit." But then he remembered that Jesus, the Son of God, had gotten upon his knees and washed the feet of his disciples. And he said, "Lord, if you can wash the feet of the disciples, I can be a boot black." God calls us to service. Have you ever thought about who the greatest one is in our church? Well, you know, you might want to nominate one of the deacons. You know, they do a lot of serving. That's right. That might be the greatest, but maybe not. And then we have elders, and they gather in session, and they make some decisions. Maybe they would be great, or maybe not. And then we have pastors, Carolyn and me, and we have two in the Hispanic congregation as well. Probably not. The Bible says that we start out with a handicap. It says that those that would be pastors and leaders are held to a higher standard. So we're already behind before we start. And maybe the greatest one is not anybody that you would necessarily name, but someone whose job and passion is serving Christ. What about in society at large? Who do we admire? Who do we think is great? Well, maybe prime minister or president, or maybe someone that has a great talent, a singer perhaps, or someone that's a great athlete. Maybe somebody that's rich, you know, Elon Musk or somebody else like that. They might be called great from the perspective of men, but God has a different ruler. And he said, the greatest is not the one that is admired by human beings. The greatest of all is the one that is the greatest servant before me. If you want to be great, be a servant. So trust the Lord even when things look bad, and serve the Lord even when you don't want to. And finally, prioritize the Lord. Jesus said in Mark 8:34, if any of you would be my follower, my disciple, you must deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. Now, look at what that says. Deny yourself. He didn't say indulge yourself like the world tells us, you know, you deserve it. You only go around once. Grab it with all the gusto that you can. Then take up your cross. He doesn't say to retire and relax. Now, Carolyn accused me the other day of not preaching but meddling. So if I'm meddling, that's okay. Yeah, I should be meddling a little bit. Take up your cross and follow me. When I was a kid, I had a couple of horses. We lived in the country. And I first got a Shetland pony that I had to train when I was about 10 years old. And then I got a quarter horse that was the fastest one in the whole neighborhood. But you know, the halter was not on me. The halter was on the horse to control it. And in the same way, Jesus is not the one with the halter. We are the ones with the halter to be following him. And Jesus said the most important thing is to follow me. When he was calling his disciples in Mark chapter 1, beginning with verse 6, it talks about how he called James and John, Andrew and Peter, and each time it said, immediately they left everything to follow him. And that's the way that it should be with us. Priority is so important. You need to decide what is most important in life. We only have, we're talking this morning, 70 years, and Gary and I have, we're living on borrowed time. We only have about 70 years, give or take, and those years need to be prioritized with Christ. I heard about some hunters, and they went hunting deer, and they broke up in two groups of two, and one group got back, and then sometime later, there was this guy hauling on his back an 8-point deer. And they said, well, where's Henry? He said, well, Henry had a stroke about 2 miles back. And they said, so you carried the deer and you left Henry? He said, well, I knew nobody was going to steal Henry. Prioritizing in life, it is the most important thing that we do. Certainly that priority is above monetary things. And we seem to think that we need so much money to take care of ourselves, but God gives us what we have that we might be a blessing to others. And he gave the example of the widow. And the widow went to the temple, and all she had was 2 mites, copper pieces that were worth almost nothing. But it was all that she had. And there were others putting in golden coins and silver coins. And Jesus said, she gave more than all the rest. She gave everything that she had. And then Mark talks about how Jesus was one day dealing with this rich young ruler. And the ruler was intrigued by Jesus. He wanted to be a follower. And he said, what must I do to be saved? And he said, from a very young age, I've been keeping the commandments. Jesus said, well, that's good. There's only one thing that you lack. Sell all that you have, give to the poor, and come and follow me. And the Bible says that young man went away sadly because he was very rich. He wanted to follow Christ, but that wasn't the priority of his life. What's the priority of our lives? What is most important? You know, when Jesus was giving one of his resurrection appearances, he was by the seashore. They had fish together. And then he was talking about John, and he indicated that maybe John would still be around when he came back. And so Peter said, well, what about him, Lord? And Jesus said, well, what is it to you? What business is that of yours, whether he's still around or not? You follow me. That is the priority of life. There's a story told about a man that was operating a lighthouse. And he was given a certain amount of fuel, and he was given the instruction, keep that thing burning every night. Well, during the month, some people came and asked for oil. There was, first of all, a woman, and she said her children were cold and she needed it to warm the house. Then there was a farmer. And the farmer said, you know, I'd really like to be able to read at night, so could you give me just a little bit to burn my lantern? And somebody else needed a little bit to be able to start an engine. And then at the end of the month, the tank ran dry, and he could not light the lighthouse, and 3 ships fell upon the rocks, and 100 people were killed. And so there was an investigation. And he told the investigator, you know, I was trying to help people. And he said, you had one responsibility, to to keep the light burning, and you failed, you are without excuse. As we stand before God, we understand that the priority is to follow Him. Jesus said, if you would be my disciple, then deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. Would you bow with me as we pray? Our gracious God, our almighty Savior, as we come before you, we realize how important discipleship is and what it means to truly be a follower of yours, where we are willing to sacrifice everything, to humble ourselves, and to trust in you. God, we pray that you might give us the grace. Let your Holy Spirit indwell us. And as we leave this place today, we pray that you will be with us in everything that we do and say. Let us, God, with our lives and our tongues, honor you. In Jesus' name, amen.